السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome to lesson 2 of our series السفرة الكرام or تجويد the art of reciting the Quran. Before we actually begin the rules of تجويد, it is very essential that we discuss the etiquette of reciting the Quran. In other words, what are those characteristics that we should strive for before we recite the Quran? And the etiquettes of recitation can be divided into two categories. The first are the spiritual etiquettes, in other words, those etiquettes that we need to psychologically and spiritually prepare ourselves with. And the second are the physical etiquettes of the Quran, in other words, what should we physically do. The spiritual etiquettes are many. Firstly, and the most important, is sincerity, ikhlas. In other words, when we recite the Quran, our intention should be to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There should be no other motivation for this recitation. The act of reciting the Qur'an is an act of worship. Therefore, if we recite the Qur'an in order to impress somebody or to show off to someone else, we have in fact directed a type of worship to another person, and this is a type of shirk or associating partners with Allah. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ All actions are judged by intentions. So whoever intended to please Allah and His Messenger will get that reward, and whoever intended other than that will get what he intended for. He will not get the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second etiquette is that of humbleness. We call it in Arabic, khushu'. When we approach the Qur'an, we should realize that this is the book of Allah azza wa jal, the very speech of Allah. We should approach it with a very humble and a very attentive frame of mind. In fact, Allah Azza wa Jal commands us in the Qur'an that if we listen to the Qur'an, we should be humble and silent. How much more so when we recite the Qur'an ourselves? Allah says in the Qur'an, وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ When the Qur'an is recited, in other words, when you are around and in the presence of the recitation of the Qur'an, then listen attentively, استمعوا, وَأَنصِتُوا and be quiet, be humble, لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ if you wish to attain the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. So if this is the commandment with regards to listening to the recitation, then what do you think about the one who actually recites? What should be his state of mind? He should be even more humble. He should feel the majesty of Allah Azza wa Jal. He should feel that this is the book of Allah, the speech of Allah. And he should approach it with that frame of mind. The third etiquette is that we should expect the reward as we recite the Qur'an. Now this is common sense, but in fact the Prophet ﷺ in many, many ahadith, he emphasized this aspect whenever talking about good deeds. And this is for a very good reason. Many times we forget the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal will reward us immensely for these small deeds. And when we realize that Allah will reward us, automatically our enthusiasm, our attention, it goes up. Let me give you an example. If someone has to do a job, and he has to do it, he is going to do it. Suppose he has to do it, but you tell him, okay, I'm going to pay you a little bit more. Maybe, you know, $100 or £100 more than usual. Will not his enthusiasm go up for that job? Of course it will. How much more so when you're talking about the rewards of Allah Azza wa Jal, the infinite rewards of Allah. So the Prophet ﷺ reminded us in many, many ahadith that when we do a good deed, we should expect the reward from Allah. Because this will help us to be attentive, it will help us in implementing these etiquettes and the physical etiquettes, and it will give us the motivation needed to learn and practice the science of tajweed. Another etiquette of reciting the Qur'an is that we should cleanse our heart of all sins. And this is a very important etiquette. Because the more sins that we have, the more barriers that will be between us and the Qur'an. And the fewer our sins, then the fewer those barriers will be. So we should try our best to minimize our sins. And the more we do so, then the better we will be able to appreciate this book of Allah Azza wa Jal. Of the physical etiquettes that are necessary before reciting the Qur'an, well, firstly, we should be in a state of purity while we actually recite. By state of purity, I mean that we should not be in the state of janaba, or sexual impurity. This is the state that we are in after intercourse or after a wet dream or any discharge. We are in a state of janaba. In order to get out of this state, we need to take a bath. It is not permissible to recite the Quran while we are in the state of janaba. However, some scholars make an exception for the women in their menses, because their menses are for so long, for so many days. Some of the scholars state that if a woman has memorized parts of the Quran and she is worried that she will forget those portions, then it is permissible for her, if she wears a glove or something, to go over those portions, even if she is in her menses. But this is only for the one who fears that she will forget what she has memorized. The second condition is that if we wish to touch the physical Quran, we must be in the state of wudu. Now let us not get confused between these two points. The first was to actually recite the Quran. To recite the Quran, you don't have to have wudu, but you have to be out of the state of janabah. But you don't have to have wudu. But to actually touch the Quran, then it is imperative, it is obligatory to be in the state of wudu, which is more than just the state of purity. The state of purity, you can be in the state of purity when you're outside of janabah. But the state of wudu is more than this. You must actually perform the wudu, and then and only then can you touch the physical Quran. If you must touch it and you don't have wudu, then try to have a barrier like a cloth or a piece of paper before touching it, because it is not permissible to touch the actual Quran, the physical Quran. We're not talking about a book of tafsir or a book of hadith, only the Quran. It is not allowed to touch the Quran unless you are in a state of wudu, because the Prophet ﷺ said, no one should touch the Quran unless he is in a state of tahir or purification or the state of wudu. The third etiquette is that we have to be considerate of the people around us. And we should choose a place where others will not be disturbed. And this is common sense in any act that we do, and especially more so for the Quran. Therefore, you should not just sit in the middle of the road and start reciting the Quran in a loud voice. This is not what is encouraged. You must make sure that wherever you are not going to disturb the people who are around you. Another etiquette is that before you start the recitation, you must seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or say, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. The meaning of أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ is, I seek refuge in you, O Allah, from shaitan, the accursed. I seek refuge in you, meaning I turn to you, O Allah. I don't turn to anyone else. I turn to you. And I seek refuge in you from the evils of shaitan, who is the accursed. And Allah has commanded us this in the Quran when He says, فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. This is an explicit verse in Surah An-Nahl, verse 98. When you recite the Quran, then seek refuge in Allah from the accursed, from the evil shaitan. فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. Therefore, every time we open up the Quran to recite it, every time we wish to recite a section of the Quran, even if it's from our memory, we should begin the recitation with أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. And one of the primary purposes of this recitation, of this استعاذة, of this seeking refuge, is that we don't want shaitan to come between us and understanding the Quran. So when we open up the Quran, the first thing that we do is we say, Oh Allah, protect me from the evils of shaitan. I want to benefit from this book directly. I don't want shaitan to come between me and this blessed book. So I seek refuge in you. I turn to you, O Allah, in order to protect me from the accursed and evil shaitan. The isti'adha, the a'udhu billah, is done right at the beginning of recitation before you actually recite. The first thing that you should do is recite the a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim. And it doesn't matter where you start from. You start from the beginning of a surah, from the middle of a surah, from the anywhere in the Quran. You must recite the isti'adha before the recitation. After this, as we all know, we say the basmala, or the phrase Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In other words, I begin this recitation mentioning the name of Allah, the ever merciful, the one full of mercy. Now the Bismillah, or the basmala is called in Arabic, this phrase is encouraged at all times when you start reciting the Quran, especially when you start at the beginning of a surah. It is even more encouraged when you start at the beginning of a surah. But it is encouraged at any place. Even if you start in the middle of a surah, it is encouraged to start with the Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. There is only one exception to this rule, and that exception, who amongst you knows it? Surah? Surah Al-Bara'ah, also known as Surah Al-Tawbah. The surah has two names in the Quran. In some Qurans it's mentioned Bara'ah, some in Qurans mentioned Tawbah. Surah Al-Tawbah or Surah Al-Bara'ah, this is the only surah which if you start reciting it, you don't say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Rather, you only say A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-Rajim, and then you start the surah immediately, Bara'atu min Allahi wa Rasulihi. This is the ninth surah in the Quran. And the reason that we don't say the Bismillah is because the Prophet ﷺ did not do so. Another etiquette is that we should recite the Quran in a moderate voice. We should not recite it in too loud or too soft of a voice. This is the general rule, and of course there are exceptions depending on the situation. But the general rule is that we should recite in a medium voice. As Allah says in the Quran, وَلَا تُجَاهِدْ بِصَلَاتِكَ وَلَا تَجْهَدْ بِصَلَاتِكَ وَلَا تُخَافِدْ بِهَا وَابْتَغِي بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ سَبِيلًا. Don't raise your voice while you're praying, in the meaning with the Quran, nor lower it to a very low level, but rather find a middle path between the two. So this is the proper way to recite. And of course, sometimes it is required that you raise your voice if everyone is listening to you. Sometimes if you're reciting secretly or privately to someone, you lower your voice. But the general rule is that you recite the Quran in a moderate voice. And inshallah, from the next episode, we will actually start the rules and the pronunciation of the letters. And I would like to remind our viewers that it is not necessary to speak or understand Arabic in order to recite the Quran properly. The recitation of the Quran is an independent science from the language. You don't have to know the grammar or the morphology or the meanings of the words or anything. All that is required is a basic knowledge of the alphabets of the Arabic language and of the diacritical marks, the marks that you put on them. The fatha, the kasra, and the dhamma. In some cultures they're the zair, zabar, and pesh. This is all that is required. A basic understanding of the Arabic alphabet. So alhamdulillah, even if you don't speak Arabic, this should not be any impediment for you to recite the Quran properly. And with this, we'll come to our recitation for today. We'll recite from Surah Al-Ikhlas, the last page of the Quran.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
قل هو الله أحد.
قل هو الله أحد.
الله الصمد.
الله الصمد.
لم يلد ولم يولد.
لم يلد ولم يولد.
ولم يكن له كفوا أحد.
ولم يكن له كفوا أحد.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
قل أعوذ برب الفلق.
قل أعوذ برب الفلق.
من شر ما خلق.
من شر ما خلق.
ومن شر غاسق إذا وقب.
ومن شر غاسق إذا وقب.
ومن شر النفاثات في العقد.
ومن شر النفاثات في العقد.
ومن شر حاسد إذا حسد.
ومن شر حاسد إذا حسد.
With this we come to the conclusion of today's episode. I hope to see you next time. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.